Good morning. We're going to begin our service by standing together and singing. Please join me in standing together as we sing, "O Come, All Ye Faithful." Just our needs, but to exalt who you are, or that you, the creator of all things, loved us enough to send your Son, your perfect Son, down to earth to pay the ultimate sacrifice that we could not pay because of your love for us. Lord, we know that if that does not cause us to worship you, or then nothing will. So Lord, I pray that you help us to be a humble people, a people who acknowledge your power, acknowledge your greatness, and worship you. Lord, help us to worship you through song, through fellowship, through listening to your word that is preached. And Lord, I just pray that everything we do will bring honor and glory to your name. Lord, we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Go ahead, take a few moments and greet each other this morning. Mishawaka to worship the Lord together. You may be here for the first time, or maybe it's the first time in a very long time. If that's the case, you're an honored guest this morning. Our ushers are coming down the aisles now to give out
cards. We just ask that you might fill that out and let us know how we can serve you as a church better. And if you're here this morning to worship the Lord, we're glad that you are here. We're going to begin with a few announcements.
Take the time to read through your bulletin. There's a number of announcements in there that we will not mention. I just want to encourage you to be here this evening. Tonight will be a time for testimonies and favorites as we end this year. This will be our last service of the year this evening, so I encourage you to be here for that. Also, next Sunday will be a little bit different arrangement in order of what we do, and there will be no Sunday school next week. I know many of you are traveling this week, and a lot of you are tired from the holidays, and so next Sunday there will not be Sunday school. We'll have our morning service, and then after our morning service we'll have a fellowship lunch, and that will be all of our services for next week. And so I encourage you, if you're planning on being here for the lunch, to sign up, and we need to know how many will be here for that. And make sure you sign up after the service or this evening as well. And then the following Sunday, we'll be starting our new Sunday school classes. You see those mentioned in there as well. Take the time to read through the rest of your announcements. But this morning, we wanted to do something a little different. If you remember, a few weeks ago, we had a special time when we recognized one of our members, Paul Morgan. He turned 90, and part of that recognition was we established a new, the Heritage Committee established a new plaque and a new memorial that they wanted to do to remember those who have served in our church faithfully. The name of the plaque is given in memory, or in honor, I should say, of Paul, so it's the Paul Morgan Award. And this morning, we wanted to give the Paul Morgan Award to three individuals who have served in our church faithfully for many years. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to read a little bit about this. This is the Heritage Committee that has done this. And I'm going to read something about each individual. I'm going to ask individuals to come up and receive the award. The first one I do want to acknowledge is Gary Schrader. As many of you know, Gary passed away, and so in a moment I'll have his wife come up and receive the award. Gary was saved on March 1st, 1964. What's interesting about Gary's story, connection to this award, is when Gary came forward that Sunday morning to acknowledge his salvation and to let that be public, the person who dealt with him was Paul Morgan. So this is the how it comes back. Gary was baptized and became a member on August 12, 1964. Gary served as a trustee, a deacon chairman, Sunday school teacher in the primary department, an Awana leader in the Sparks, and then the director of the Pioneer Club. He maintained and serviced the church vans and buses and drove the bus to bring children and adults to Sunday school and church. For Vacation Bible School, he drove the bus that picked up children and drove the junior high children to some of their activities. In 1991, Gary flew to Bangladesh to help Ken James with repairs after a hurricane damaged the hospital that Ken worked in. In 2013, Gary went back to Bangladesh to help John Long, who was serving as a short-term missionary. Gary started the men's prayer time that met to pray on Mondays and Fridays at 6 a.m. at the church. He was very active in the setup of the live nativity scene that we have done for many years. He was a large part of that. He would take the sheep to his home and keep them overnight in his garage because it was a live scene on Saturday and Sunday night at that time. On Memorial Day, him and his wife were involved in filling up many balloons with helium that were handed out at the parade, and he worked serving refreshments at the church provided for the people who came to the parade. He will receive and has received his rewards in heaven. I'm thankful for Gary and Gary's involvement that he had for many years in our church, and so at this time we do want to recognize Gary through his wife, and so Pat, if you will come forward. Thankful for Pat. I know this is not easy, but we are thankful. So let's give Gary and Pat a hand. Gary was a large part of many of your lives, and I know this probably won't be effective because many of them are in the balcony, but how many of you had Gary for a Sunday school teacher? If you did, just raise your hand. Okay. A lot of them are in the balcony because they're teenagers and they hide up there. But many people had Gary as a Sunday school teacher, and we are thankful for that. The next one we want to recognize is Ken James. I want to read something that was written about Ken James. Ken James was saved as a child. He helped his father build Stuart Memorial Baptist Church in South Bend. In 1977, he became head of maintenance at Brethren Christian School in Osceola, where he first met David Miller, who was the administrator of the school, and then became head of maintenance at Dublin in New Hampshire. He became a member of First Baptist in 1981. Ken and Sue and their families were called to be missionaries to Bangladesh and started their work in January of 1983 and spent 20 years there serving the Lord until January of 2003. Since that time, Ken has served in the church in many areas as a trustee, a deacon, adult Sunday school teacher, on the missionary committee, in the Young at Heart, and in the Helping Hands ministry. He also has taught, this is news to me, I didn't know this, he taught shop classes in the school as well. Ken served for many years maintaining the buses and vans and was in charge of snow removal on the church grounds. With the many skills that God has given him, he has maintained the church buildings. He's added air conditioning to this part of the building. He has remodeled the heritage room. He put in a new restroom downstairs and remodeled the area down there that is now the Little Scholars Preschool area. And at the present, he has done much work on the new restrooms on the first floor and also on what's going on in our fellowship hall. Ken has done a lot, and many of you know Ken has gone through some physical trials recently, and so he hasn't been involved as much as he would like. But still, even many days where he's physically hurting, I've seen him here working. And so I am thankful for Ken. And so at this time, I would like to recognize Ken James for the Paul Morgan Award. Let's give him a hand as well. Final one that we want to mention, and that is Jim Dewey. And many of you know this, that Jim and Mary are moving, and so today is their last Sunday with us. Now, they will be back in the summer. They have promised that, and we'll hold them to that. And but they will be missed. And so I want to read to you what we have here. Jim Dewey was saved on May 12, 1967, at the age of 27, at Victory Baptist Church in Chesapeake, Virginia, when evangelist Ron Comfort presented the gospel message. In 2004, he and his wife became members of First Baptist. He has served on the trustee boards and the Helping Hands ministry. With the skills God has given him, he has helped with the electrical, plumbing, and major repairs, adding air conditioning to this part of the building, remodeling the school library so it could be used as the heritage room, putting in a new bathroom, and the area in the basement for children's ministry. At the present, along with Ken, he is working on the new restrooms on the first floor. And we will miss them as they move. Jim has done a lot. Jim was determined, I want to say this, Jim was determined to get at least one of the new restrooms done before he left. And everything that he could possibly do, he did. He spent many hours this week here. I think he was here more than I was this week. So, we are thankful for Jim. And so at this time, we want to recognize Jim for the Paul Morgan Award. Also, I do want to give him and Mary a little gift to thank them for their years of ministry here. So let's give them a hand as well. We do this as a reminder to all of us that service to God is important, service to God is required, but also Scripture says service to God is rewarded. And whether that is here or in eternity, God rewards those who faithfully serve Him, and I am thankful for these men and their faithful service. At this time, I'm going to have our ushers to come. We're going to take our morning worship offering. Let's pray. God, we are thankful for the blessing of knowing and being a part of and serving with these three men. Lord, we know that the glory ultimately goes to you. We know that it is because of these men and men like them that your work continues. Lord, and we know that sometimes some work seems that it's unnoticed, but we know nothing is unnoticed by you. Or maybe there is aspects that these men did that we as a church don't even know about, but you do. Lord, we're thankful for the privilege we have of being a part of their lives and have had. We're thankful for how you continue to use and will use them and their families. Lord, I just pray that you will help all of us to strive to be servants in the same way. Lord, now as we take our offering, Lord, I pray that you will use it to further your ministry. Lord, that we will show our worship to you and our service to you by giving back to you. We ask that you are glorified. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Ministering to us with joyful, we adore thee. We're going to move into our worship and song portion. If you please join me in standing together. Hebrews 2:14 says, "Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil." Our Savior Jesus Christ took on human flesh in order that he might destroy the power of death in our lives for those who have faith in him. So we're going to continue by singing the song that we began to learn last week, He is mighty. Speaking, it has been testified somewhere, "What is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him? You made him for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, putting everything in subjection under his feet." Now, in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him. But we see him for a little while, was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. For surely it is not angels that he helps, but he helps the offspring of Abraham. We rejoice in the time of Christmas to celebrate that Jesus was made low for us. And that story is told in the song, The First Noel, which we'll sing next. The First Noel. Thank you. celebrate the coming of your Son as we have spent time with our families and been very busy with the aspects of Christmas. I just pray that you would help us to open our hearts for the preaching of your word as Pastor Pete comes and teaches us, and you would teach us your truth and implant your word in our hearts to change us, to help us to grow, to help us to prepare room in our hearts for the truth that you have made for us, that you have preserved for us in your word. We ask that this morning would be a time of growth in your word, a time of encouragement. Help it not to be a time of distraction, but a time to be able to focus upon you and your truth. We thank you for the privilege of being able to meet together as your church, your body, your people. I pray that this morning we would be strengthened together and built up in our faith. In Jesus' name, amen. If you are able, would you please join me in standing one final time as we sing together, Prepare Him Room. Church may be dismissed.
Take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1. It is good to have you with us. I know many of our families are traveling and are away at this time, or some of you are planning on going away either this afternoon or tomorrow. So continue to pray for your safety and enjoy your time with your family. We're going to continue our Nativity series talking about what child is this. We talked about 2 weeks ago about that Jesus is King. Last week we talked about Jesus as Savior, and I want to conclude the series talking about Jesus is our God. Matthew chapter 1, and I will read. You can follow along in your Bibles. Matthew chapter 1, starting in verse 22, it says, "All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son. And he called his name Jesus." Let's pray. God, we are thankful that we can study this passage. We are thankful that we can know that Jesus came, not just as a man, although he did that, but as God, so that he could spend time with us and dwell among us and know our infirmities and suffer so that we could have forgiveness. Lord, I pray that you'll help us as we go through this message. Lord, help me that my words will not be my own, Lord, but that they will be from you. Lord, we ask that you are glorified. We ask this in your name. Amen. After many failed attempts, in December of 1903, Orville and Wilbur Wright finally got their flying machine off the ground. If you've been to the Smithsonian, we were there this summer, you were able to see the replica of it, and quite an interesting plane. When that happened, the airplane was born. In their excitement, they sent word to many people, and one of the people they sent word to was their sister, Catherine. They sent her a telegraph, and they were limited in what they could put, and so they simply said this: "Flew 120 feet, will be home for Christmas." When Catherine got the news, she ran immediately to the local newspaper, thinking this was a story that the editor needed to see. And so she took the telegraph to him, and he glanced at the telegraph, and he looked back at her, and he said, "That's nice that the boys will be home for Christmas," and gave her back the telegraph and walked away. He completely missed the point. He missed, yes, it was nice that the boys were coming home for Christmas, but he missed the big news. He missed that for the first time ever, man had flown an airplane. That was the big news. But how often do we miss the big news at Christmas? All too often we're caught up in the tinsel, and we're caught up in the lights, and we're caught up in the shopping and the gifts and the excitement, and we miss the real meaning. And those are all nice, and those are all fun, and those can all be a good thing, but we miss them. I'm sure the Wright brothers, their family was happy to see them, but that wasn't the big news. The big news for us today is that God became a man over 2,000 years ago in order that we can have a relationship with him. I want to take some time to talk about that. Because today the world will tell you that Christianity is no different than any other world religion. If you were to go to most colleges today and take a religion class, you will find that's being taught that the professor will tell you that there's no difference between the Christian God and any other religion. They will tell you that all religions are exactly the same. Even today, there's Christian professors that are teaching the same thing. Just heard just this week that a professor at Wheaton College is teaching that. You know what? They're almost right. Because all religions of this world are essentially the same. That is, except for one. Every religion in this world, whether it's you're talking about Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, Mormonism, paganism, New Age, all of them are the same. Every religion in the world requires that man do something to work his way up to God. In fact, many of those religions teach that it's not just about working your way up to God, it's about becoming a God. Becoming one with God. And that is the thing that all religions have in common. All religions require men to do something, to attempt to become divine, to become God, all except one. All of them except biblical Christianity. Because you see, the goal of Christianity isn't to become God. The goal of Christianity is to have a relationship with God. The goal of Christianity is to know God. And God is God, and we are not. And we will never be God. And we will never be exactly like God. God is far too holy. God is far too perfect. God is far too righteous. God is far too pure. God is far too powerful for us to be like Him or even imagine what He is like. We can never become God. We're too frail. We're too imperfect. We're too sinful. We're too messed up to become God. We can never become God, but that's why He became man. God had to become man, not so that we could become like Him, but so that in all of our sin and imperfections, we could have a relationship with Him. In order that God might have a relationship with us, God sent His Son, who stepped down into human form and stepped down from heaven and became man. And I want us to understand that thought this morning. It's really a deep doctrine to study. It's really something we could take a long time to look at, but really that the idea is Jesus came to earth as a man so that He could have a relationship with you. We'll look at this morning three aspects of our relationship with God that God desires for us to have. And the first one, if you'll turn the screen here, it's slow this morning. The first one is God desires a human relationship. God desires a human relationship. God wants us to have a normal relationship with Him. If you look at Matthew chapter 1 again in verse 23, just look at the beginning. It says, "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son." God came as a baby. Think about that for a moment. Do you remember being around babies? We have had a number of ladies in our church have babies recently. And so I enjoy that process. I do not enjoy the parenting of a baby. It's easier to just go and grab someone else's baby and hold it and say, "Oh, that's cute, that's pretty," and then walk away and hand it back to mom. But do you remember being a parent of a baby, or do you remember being around a baby? And what are the babies are cute, aren't they? I mean, every parent believes they have the cutest baby in the history of mankind. How many of you had the cutest baby ever? Look at that. If you didn't raise your hand and you have kids, and your kids now are angry at you, so you should have. Okay, but parents think their baby's the cutest. Why is it that, I mean, that's why parents take hundreds of pictures of the baby. They haven't changed their pose, they haven't changed their look, but somehow this picture is better than the last one, isn't it? Unless, you know, it's the second born or the third born or on down, then we stop taking pictures. But people love holding babies. They love touching soft baby skin. People love staring at babies. You love listening to baby talk. Parents imagine that their baby advances faster than any other baby, don't they? I mean, they look and they go, "Aw, isn't that the cutest baby? My baby did this. I don't know if any baby's ever done that before, but mine did." As if your baby's better. We love kissing babies' soft little cheeks. But on the other hand, babies are gross. I mean, think about it for a minute. They have no control of their bodily functions whatsoever. Zero control. I mean, they have no control at all. They stink. They smell. You walk in the room, I mean, you walk into our nursery and it smells all the time. They burp all the time. They produce other disgusting smells and substances that we won't want to talk about here. As parents, how many times have you had to change a massive diaper blowout? It's no fun. Think about it for a moment. What an odd way for the creator of the universe to enter His creation. Why would God's Son subject Himself to that? Why would God's Son, who created all things, subject himself to the drooling and the spitting up and the dirty diapers? A story is told about an old farmer who asked the same question. He thought the idea of God coming to earth as a man was ridiculous. One evening, during a really terrible snowstorm, he was in his house and he kept hearing loud thumps on his living room window, and the snow was so bad that he couldn't even see outside to see what it was, and so he just kept hearing it. And finally, the snow let up a little bit, so he got brave enough to head outside. And it turned out that a flock of geese had been flying, and because of the weather, they just couldn't handle it anymore. And so they came down, and they got disoriented, and they didn't know what they were doing, and they were kind of going all over the place, going crazy. And every once in a while, in the craziness, they run into the window of his house, not knowing what it was. And the farmer knew that if they stayed in this condition, eventually they would either kill themselves by running through a window, or they would die of cold. So he decided he had to do something about it. He opened up, went over to his barn, and he opened up his barn door. He turned on the light so that they could see the light, and he tried to get them to go, but they were so scared that even when he came close to them, they would go the other direction, and he couldn't get them to go into the barn, and he couldn't do anything about it. Finally, a thought came to him. If I could just become a goose, then I could save them. If I could just become one of them, then I could tell them this is the best way to go. This is the best place to be. And suddenly, while he was thinking that, he realized that's why Jesus came to earth. It wasn't that ridiculous after all. In Jesus' humanity, he had to endure anything that you could possibly imagine. He had to endure physical struggles, hunger, poverty, pain. He had to endure emotional struggles. I mean, in my Sunday school class this morning, we talked about Judas. He was betrayed by a friend. He was rejected by his own family. He was mocked. He was made fun of. And Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 15, if you'll turn the slide there. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, it says, "We do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses." What does it tell us? We have one who in every respect was tempted as we are, yet without sin. Jesus came to have a relationship with us. The word relationship comes from the root word, which means to relate. Jesus had to come to earth as a man in order to relate to us. In our sin and weakness, there was no way we would ever be good enough to relate to God. There's no way in our imperfection, you know, I spend a lot of time counseling people, you know what I find out? None of us understands who God is. Because none of us in our sinfulness can understand how God can do anything. And so there's no way we are ever going to be good enough to relate to God. And so Jesus came down and God reached into history and took our own infirmities so that he could relate to us. He struggled in life with things we do as well. Like I said, he went through the baby stage of dirty diapers and burping all the time. He went through the clumsy stage of trying to learn how to walk and falling over. He went through the stage of skinned knees and skinned elbows and running to mom because it hurt. He went through early adolescence of body changes. Oh, that's a scary time, isn't it? He went through the difficulty of acne and other teen issues. He had to deal with mean siblings. He had to deal with family issues. He probably saw many times where his parents struggled. They struggled to relate to him. They struggled with finances. His father was a carpenter. He was poor. There's probably many days where they didn't have as much food as they needed or wanted. He became a man. He hurt. It says in that passage, it says, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son." It doesn't say a virgin shall conceive and bear a God, a son. He became man in order to have a human relationship with us, to understand us. He became man in order to save us. But the second thing, God desires a human relationship with us. But the second one is, God desires a holy relationship with us. Look at the second part of the verse there. It says that, behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. This passage comes from a prophecy given by Isaiah to describe the circumstances that surrounded and would surround the coming of the Messiah. And they were told that the Messiah would come, and through the Old Testament, you can see woven through the Old Testament detail after detail of what it means that Jesus is going to come. And Isaiah comes along and he says to them, in the next slide there, he says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. There's going to be a sign that you're going to know it's the Messiah. And what's the Messiah? The sign? The sign is, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. This name is given to reflect who God was going to be. Who this child that was going to be born to this virgin was going to be. This child was going to be given the name Emmanuel. Now Matthew, in his writing, as we see here, he adds to that. He tells the people, he says, why was he given the name Emmanuel? Because Emmanuel means God with us. It doesn't mean God is only a man. It means God comes down to earth and becomes one of us. By giving us this name of the Messiah, God wanted us to know that this was not just an ordinary baby. This was a baby who came and suffered and went through all the things we did, but he was God. He was establishing him in a different position than as a son. He was one of us, but as God. He was one of us, yet he is Almighty God. God desires for us to know that about himself. That he didn't come just as a man. He came as a man who was still God. And he desires for us to understand it because he wants us to understand that he is holy and have a holy relationship with us. In 1 Samuel chapter 2 and verse 2, it tells us there in that passage, there is none holy like the Lord, for there is none beside you. God is holy. His holiness means that he's high and lifted up. His holiness means that he's righteous, that he is powerful, that he is all-knowing, that he is everywhere at once, that he is infinite. That's who he is. He's perfect. No words can accurately describe that. God is holy. God is perfect. And because God is holy and God is perfect, he cannot tolerate profane and imperfect things. If he did, it would take away from his holiness. If he did, his holiness would be tainted. Imagine, if you will, many of you would probably like this, it's now summertime. It's 90 degrees outside. Okay, maybe that's too hot, but for my illustration, it's a good number. It's 90 degrees outside, and you decide you got to go mow your lawn. You don't want to mow your lawn because it's really hot, but you got to go out and mow your lawn. If you're like me, my wife would attest to this, if I go out and mow my lawn in 90 degree weather, I'm going to come in and I'm going to be a mess. Okay, I'm going to be one sweaty mess. I sweat a lot and I wouldn't have a dry spot in my clothing. Okay, but not only that, with that temperature, it would be dusty, it would be dirty, my clothes would be nasty, I would stink, I would smell. I would walk in the house and I would take my dirty clothes and I would put them back in my drawer, correct? Why not? No, I would put them with the dirty clothes. I probably would burn them. No, but I probably should. But I would put them there. Why? Because the same is true with our relationship with God. He is holy. He is clean. He is without filth. And yet we are filthy. We can't be in his presence. We can't be around him. So how can an infinitely holy, perfect God have a relationship with a weak, sinful, and frail people like you and me? He can. But it's not based on what we do. As I said at the beginning, every other religion in the world says it's based on your performance. It's not based on anything we do. It isn't based on anything we've earned. In fact, Scripture tells us anything that we've earned in relationship to God is just actually dirty garments. You look at the next passage on the screen in Isaiah 64 in verse 6. Notice what it says. It says, we have all become like one who is unclean. That there's a reference to a leper. Back in the Bible times, someone who had the disease of leprosy was so seen as unclean that they were not allowed to be anywhere near other people. You see the stories when Jesus would heal people. Actually, when they were healed of leprosy, they had to go to the priest to be made clean in the eyes of the people. It goes on and it says, and all our righteous deeds are like a polluted garment. It's a dirty image. It's an unclean garment that is rags that are discarded during a woman's menstruation. It's gross. It's not something that we want to talk about. And here in this passage, God says our best efforts are like that. The best we can possibly do, comparison to this holy God, is dirty. His holiness, His righteousness, is embodied in the person of Jesus Christ. When Jesus came to save us, Scripture tells us when Jesus came to earth and He died on the cross, this holy, perfect God, His holiness then is imputed to us. His righteousness then is given to us. That's why it tells us in the next verse on the screen in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, it says, for our sake, He made Him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. I do not stand up here a righteous person because of my own efforts, because my own efforts always, always fall short. I stand up here knowing that I have the righteousness of God because of what Jesus Christ did. If you're saved, when God the Father looks at you, all He sees is His Son. He doesn't see your imperfections. He doesn't see your frailties. He doesn't see your sin. He's forgiven them. And Scripture says He's forgiven them as far as the east is from the west. All He sees is His Son. His righteous Son. His holy Son. The question is asked, how does that work? How does it work that God desires a human relationship with us, so He came down in the form of a man? Because I gave you the illustration of the farmer, and he said, if only I could become a goose. But here's the thing, if a farmer became a goose, he'd just be as foolish as the other geese. If it was just about God coming down, if Jesus was only a man, He would only be able to sympathize with us. He wouldn't be able to actually save us. So how does it work? The last thing we want to look at is God desires a complete relationship with you. It's not just enough that God came as a man. It's not just enough that God came as God. He desires a complete, total relationship with us. If God had only sent Him as a man, He would have only been able to sympathize with us. He couldn't have saved us. If God had only come to us as God, He could only come to condemn us. He couldn't save us. But God came to us as both. Scripture makes that very clear. He sent Jesus to be born of a virgin as a man, fully man, 100% man. And He sent His Son Jesus to be conceived of the Spirit as God, fully God, 100% God. Jesus is 100% God. Jesus is 100% man. And it might sound confusing, and I don't fully get it. And you say, well, I don't fully get it. Well, join the crowd. But God says it's true. And God is powerful enough to do it. On Friday, we celebrated the fact that over 2,000 years ago, an infinite God stepped into history. He stepped into time that He created, although He's not bound by it. And yet He placed Himself in a position to be bound by it. He reached down through His infinite power and majesty. When He, on Christmas morning, as we call it, on Christmas morning, cried that first helpless cry of a baby. He was wrapped in swaddling clothes. And as He lied there in that manger as a baby, cute and cuddly and at the same time disgusting because he was a baby. Yet he was fully God and fully man. That's an incredible thought. God had something great to accomplish with this baby. What can we learn from it? The idea that Jesus came down and was fully God and fully man is a term that we call the incarnation of Christ. And in closing, I just want to look at for a few moments, what are some lessons that we can learn from the incarnation of Christ. First of all, number one, I'll skip to the next one, sorry, I missed that. First one, the incarnation shows us Christ's vast love for us. And also in addition to that, the importance of us loving others. We all know the verse, John 3:16, that says what? God so loved the world that he did what? He gave his only son. That's the reason for the incarnation. Why did God do that? Why did God place his son into the body of a human being? Because he loves us. Because he cares for you in your flawed and imperfect state. Because he loves you. This is God becoming man and doing so because of his incredible love for us. And you know what? Christ tells us to love one another as he first loved us. Christ is our example of love. And can you think of anything more great than that? Not only that, God not only came down in human form and lived the life of a human, but he died. And not just an ordinary death. I mean, if it was an ordinary death, you know, that'd be one thing. But he died a horrific, horrible death because of his love for us. So then let me ask you this question. Is there anything too low or too far that you can do to show others that you love them? Is there anything too difficult? Is there anything outside of the bounds of love that we can show to others? I think the answer to that is no. But how often do we struggle to show love to others? The incarnation shows us Christ's vast love for us. Secondly, the incarnation shows us Christ's humility in coming to earth. And the opposite of that is the necessity of our own humility. Isn't it amazing that humility characterizes the King of Kings? The very first week as we looked at this Nativity series, we looked at the beginning of Matthew, and we looked at the genealogy that Jesus descended from royalty because he is royalty. He is the King of Kings, and yet, as being the King of Kings, he humbled himself. He humbled himself. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 8 tells us that. It says, in being found in human form, he humbled himself. That was humbling. It could be humiliating. Yet he humbled himself. Scripture says he became obedient, even to the point of the cross. Humility is necessary. Because humility we see exemplified in the incarnation. Yet how often do we struggle being humble? How often do we struggle wanting to let everyone know that we're a little bit more superior than they are? Yet God tells us in his word that Jesus humbled himself. And the last thing the incarnation teaches us is the incarnation shows us that nothing is impossible with God. What's interesting is if you were to turn there, we're not going to look there right now, but if you were to look the counter passage, we looked at Matthew of when the angel came to Joseph, but if you were to look at Luke, when the angel came to Mary and told Mary, you're going to conceive a child that's going to be end up being the Savior of the world, and an inconceivable thought for her. The angel ended with these words. It said, nothing will be impossible with God. The Christmas story is a series of impossibilities. It's fulfilled prophecies, shocking revelation, mind-blowing miracles. International upheaval in a single epic event of love and power that was displayed by Jesus Christ. And it shows us nothing is impossible with God. And that truth has implications beyond just the incarnation. That truth has implications to us today. How often do we think, oh, I don't know if God can do this. God can do anything. God can do anything. If God can orchestrate the events of Christmas, God can do absolutely anything for us. The baby whose birthday we celebrated was born to die. He was born to die so you wouldn't have to. He was born to die so that you could have a relationship with your Maker, because without his birth, you never could. But not only was he born to die, he was born to live, making a relationship possible with us and the Father. If Jesus would have came to earth and he would have been placed into the body of a man and he would have came as God, but yet he came to the point of the cross and he died and he stayed dead, you know what? He could never allow us to have the relationship that we have. But I want to ask you a question today. Do you have a relationship with God today? Because that's why Jesus came as a baby. Came as a baby to reconcile a broken relationship. So do you have a relationship with Jesus today? The relationship that Jesus provided for you free. There's nothing that you need to do. There's no level of righteousness that you need to achieve. It's free. It's a gift. And yet, at the same time, it requires our all. In humility, in love, giving back to him. He paid all that could ever be paid when he gave his life on the cross. He was born to die so that you can live. Again, I come back and my question is, do you have a relationship with him today? Let's pray. God, we are truly grateful that you made the sacrifice of sending your Son to earth. Lord, we're thankful for this time of year that we can be reminded of a baby that was in a manger. Lord, this was not an ordinary baby. God, I am so grateful that it wasn't. I'm so thankful that Jesus was fully God, that he humbled himself enough to do the lowly task of living a life like we live, to show us that a relationship with God is possible. Lord, if there's any here this morning who haven't accepted the relationship that you offer, the relationship that is only possible through Jesus Christ, I pray that you will help them today to see that need and to turn to you. But God, for those that are believers, for those that have begun a relationship with you, Lord, I pray that you'll help them to take an account of the current condition of their relationship. Or maybe they've allowed sin again to build a wall, a barrier. I pray that you'll help them to break that down. Lord, maybe even as we looked at these lessons of the incarnation, Lord, help us to see the love that Jesus modeled and to live that love in our own lives. And Lord, maybe there's some in here today that are struggling with that. There's someone that they're having a hard time loving. Maybe there's someone here that's full of pride, thinking that they've achieved something on their own, that they've become a Christian because of something good they've done, that they are someone that they can be proud of. Lord, help us to be humble, to serve. Lord, even as we think about the individuals that we recognized earlier, all of them are humble, faithful servants. I pray you help us to emulate them. Lord, and as we think about the last thing is that nothing is impossible. You are a great God. Lord, help us to never lack in faith for you. Thank you for this time that we can look in your word. We ask this in your name. Amen. Pastor Nate.
Please join me in standing together as we sing, "You Will Hold Me Fast."
To seeing you next week, and we're gonna sing one more verse of this song, and then we'll close our service with a word of prayer.
For my life he bled and died, Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied, he will hold me fast. Grace within to
that you have satisfied your own justice through your Son, Jesus Christ, through his death on a cross and resurrection from the grave. We have eternal life. We have hope in him. We are thankful for that love that has been shed abroad in our hearts through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we pray that this week, as we live as lights in this world, that you would give to us strength, encouragement to live out your word, to share your gospel as you give us opportunity to do so. Pray that you would help those who are out of town, who are traveling, as they return to Mishawaka over the next several days or the next week. You would give safety, that you bring the body back together again next week according to your will. We do pray for Joe Bissick with his scheduled surgery coming up in the next week and a half or so. You would give to him strength and grace. You would give skill to those who will be operating with him and dealing with him. You give wisdom. And we pray that you would bless those, again, who are not here today, perhaps because of sickness. You would give them strength, encourage them in your word, and that you would bring us back again safely next week. In Jesus' name, amen.